In an important ruling, the Supreme Court of India has thwarted the Revenue Department's attempt to tax loan write-offs. Experts say that this apex court ruling will have implications for companies facing insolvency proceedings. In the last couple of years, companies such as JSW Steel, Mahindra & Mahindra, Jindal Equipments and several others have got different outcomes for the same problem, thanks to the differing High Court rulings on whether loan write-offs can be taxed by the Revenue Department. In all these cases, the Tax Department had sought to tax the principal amount of the loan in the hands of the borrower once it was waived off by the lender.
So the sum and substance is, whenever a loan is being taken by the borrower and whose end use is to meet the capex requirement, whether the waiver of such loan by the lender will tantamount to income in the hands of the borrower or not. That is a short summary of this particular bone of contention in this particular case. Waiver by the lender of a loan whose end use is basically nothing but to finance the capex of the borrower, whether such kind of waiver will be taxed under the Income Tax Act or not.
The Bombay and Delhi High Court had answered this question in the negative. The courts had held that a loan which is originally taken for capital expenditure, if waived, will not give rise to taxable income either under Section 41(1) or Section 28(4). These are the two sections under the Income Tax Act which the Tax Department had used to make its case. Section 41(1) says that if a taxpayer has availed of a deduction as a result of loss on a trading liability and in any subsequent year the creditor waives this liability, then this benefit will be treated as income. Section 28(4) treats any benefit, whether convertible into money or not, arising from business as profit that would attract tax. It's under this section that the Madras High Court had held that waiver of a portion of the loan would tantamount to a benefit.
The courts primarily took the view that since this is a benefit in cash, it is a monetary benefit, therefore it is not within the scope of Section 28(4). Now, the Delhi High Court, you have, divergent views from the Delhi High Court as also the Bombay High Court. Originally, the Bombay High Court was in favor, but in a later decision in the case of, solid containers, the Bombay High Court took a different view. And they took a different view in the context of waiver of a loan. And they said that when there is a waiver of the loan which is, used for working capital purposes, that will amount to income.
The fact number one, which is quite important to any kind of a litigation under this kind of a matter, is what is the end use of this particular loan, whether for capex or for meeting any trading transaction or normal transaction of the borrower. Whether, second aspect, whether the borrower has actually taken a deduction in its books of accounts or not. If these two facts can be ascertained without any ambiguity, then I think the Supreme Court judgment can be applied vis-a-vis Section 41 of the Income Tax Act, because this Supreme Court judgment is also based upon these two aspects. And in the Madras High Court judgment which you have just talked about is basically, in that particular judgment, the SSC has taken a deduction. So since one of this particular fact has been negated in this particular in that particular judgment, therefore the Madras High Court has given non-favorable judgment vis-a-vis the Delhi and the Bombay High Court, which has given a favorable judgment only on account of these two facts.
But the Supreme Court made no distinction based on the end use of the loan. It held that for Section 28(4) to apply, the benefit cannot be in the form of money and has to arise from the business. And since waiver of loan does not amount to cessation of trading liability, Section 41(1) cannot be applied.
As you see, 41(1), the cardinal requirement is the amount should have been allowed deduction in any earlier year. And there is subsequently a remission of a trading liability, in which case, in the year of remission, the amount can be taxed as deemed income under Section 41(1). Now, the principal requirement that the amount should be allowed deduction is not satisfied in the context of a loan taken, because a loan transaction is on capital account. You don't claim deduction when you borrow a loan. That is a balance sheet item. You claim deduction for the interest payable on the loan. So, when the principal amount of loan is waived, since this requirement, this condition precedent of the deduction having been claimed and allowed for the principal amount of loan is not satisfied, Section 41(1) does not apply. And the court further added that loan is not like a trading liability. So there is no remission of a trading liability when there is waiver of principal amount of loan.
In this particular Mahindra judgment, there is one peculiar fact that the borrower has not taken the deduction of the interest, and the Supreme Court and the Bombay High Court at many places has recorded this fact that no deduction of interest has been taken by the impugned entity, which is basically nothing but a Mahindra entity. So assumingly, suppose this particular fact was not in this situation, or rather this particular fact was the against, that means the Mahindra would have taken the deduction of this particular interest. Now the question arises whether the income should be treated only to the extent of interest or the entire principal amount, because law is not that clear upon this particular aspect. If a deduction against a loan, that means deduction of interest has been taken against a loan, whether only the interest waived off will be taxable or the entire loan. And there could be a possibility where the lender is only waiving off the principal amount but not waiving off the interest amount, and the borrower has taken a deduction of the interest amount. So what will happen? Whether at all any principal amount can be added back? So this particular judgment does not give any kind of finding on this particular aspect.
Supreme Court took the primary view that Section 28(4) will not include within its ambit any monetary benefit. So if there is a waiver of principal amount of loan, notwithstanding the utilization of the loan, whether for meeting capital commitments or for defraying revenue expenditure, since it is in the nature of a monetary benefit, it is not a non-cash benefit, that cannot be taxed under 28(4). So therefore, they did not deem it necessary to go into the distinction and the bifurcation that the courts had drawn between the user of and the end use of the borrowed money.
Experts say that this apex court ruling will be useful for insolvent companies and their potential investors, since loan write-offs are a standard feature of any resolution plan.
This ruling is welcome in the sense that it settles the controversy once and for all, that on waiver of the principal amount of loan, notwithstanding again the end use of the borrowed funds, this amount will not be taxable as the income of the company, of the borrower company. So to that extent, it will help the plans of reviving even companies which are under the insolvency code, by saying that the white knight who steps in will actually not be having to pay tax on the amount of the haircut that is extended by banks, other institutions, qua the principal amount of loan.
Insolvency companies can certainly take advantage of this particular judgment. And rather, I will divide the insolvency companies into two parts. The first category, who has not even paid the principal as well as the interest. And the second category, who hasn't paid the principal amount but has paid some amount of the interest to the lenders. The reason why I have divided into two categories, because the first category, which has not paid not even a interest as well as the principal amount, and the entire loan, that means the principal as well as the interest amount gets waived off, they certainly can take benefit of this particular judgment without any ambiguity. But the second portion, the second category, who has actually paid some amount of interest but not even a single penny on account of the principal amount, that needs to be seen to what extent they can actually take advantage of this particular judgment. Obviously, the taxpayer, that means the borrower company, the IBC company, will try to seek advantage of this particular judgment in those cases also. But to my mind, the tax department is bound to, or rather is going to litigate by making a distinction of this particular Supreme Court judgment, and they might argue before the High Court also, this particular Supreme Court judgment cannot be relied upon by the taxpayer, because this particular judgment is based upon the fact no interest deduction has been taken. And the law is still open for the interpretation in an event interest deduction has been taken.
While it's too early in the insolvency regime to anticipate similar demands from the tax department, the ruling will be useful for insolvent companies if it comes to that. Keeping with the insolvency theme, M.S. Sahu, chairman of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board, told Bloomberg Quint earlier this week that even though courts have directed creditors committees to allow late and losing bidders to participate, and some in India Inc. have suggested that e-auctions should be followed in the bidding process, going the auction route is not the best idea. Here's a slice of that conversation. You can read and watch the full interview on Bloomberg Quint's Law and Policy page. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next week.
See, the law requires value maximization of the corporate debtor. It does not talk about value maximization of a set of stakeholders. Second, as I told, it is a resolution plan. It's not a bidding or auction mechanism, which will come if the company does not go through resolution successfully and it gets into liquidation. At that stage, there is a provision for auction or bidding. The intention of at the resolution stage is not a bidding or auction, it is a resolution plan, and that is why the law provides so much of support to make a resolution happen.